Okay, good afternoon. I'm really happy that you are here and we have 10 minutes or 12 minutes to talk about this story, so please relax. We have plenty of time for it. So let me just tell you that my name is Catalina, and I am here to tell you this story about how you two predicted very well the evolutionary history of these two animal hummingbirds. So let me just start with these three dots, because one of the major questions we still have is how is it possible that these species, population, my favorite is lineage, so this lineage become these differentiated lineages. So we know that for this to happen, there are different ingredients. So we have variation, and we have effective population size. We have time, space, and related with space, we have geographical barriers. And if you put all these together, you have the mechanism of genetic drift. But there is also selection. So some variants could be selected in favor or could be selected against, according to different pressures that could be related with ecology or with sexual preferences. But we also have migration or gene flow that will, in general, act against to the divergence of the lineages. So this is true for all the living systems. So all these mechanisms are acting in all the living systems. But the main question we still have is for the different systems that we have. And the difference between the system is how much of these forces are acting on them, or what of these forces mainly drive the divergence between the lineages. So, as you know by the name of my talk, I work with hummingbirds, not only because they are beautiful, but because they are very interesting. And in the phylogeny of the hummingbirds, there is this Andean clade. There are the brilliants inside that Andean clade, and inside the brilliants, there is the genus Selinia. Juan Luis Parra, in 2009, and his college, were working in the phylogeny of this genus, and they used two mitochondrial markers and three nuclear markers to resolve the phylogeny of this genus. And it works pretty well with one exception, the species Selinia helianta and Selinia bonaparte. And I know that you don't see anything of that here, so I put it bigger. And this is what they got. They have four sequences of these species that become mixed in a single clade. This was unexpected. And the reason is that they are very different. So as you can see, the golden belly star from left has pretty much all the underparts golden. And the blue-throated star from left has the underpart, the belly is rose, and the rump is aquamarine. Also, this is darker than this other. From now on, I'm going to call this complete species as CB and this complete species as CH. And I said complete because actually there are subspecies. So this is the distribution of the CB subspecies. We have Concita in the eastern mountain range of the Colombian Andes. We have, what is it? Bonaparte? Okay, this is Bonaparte. This is Concita in the northern, in the Serranía del Perijá, and there is Eos in the Serranía de Mérida in Venezuela. So some authors consider Eos as a different species, but currently it's considered still a subspecies by the classification company. This is the distribution of CH, and in this distribution there are two subspecies too, Tamay and Helianta, both in the Colombian Andes. So as you see here, there is a zone of contact between the two species. Well, we tried to resolve this mess first using mitochondrial markers, but with a larger sample, And the first thing that you notice here is that this else is another thing. It's not part of CV. So we will consider it as a different species, and we won't include it anymore in the following analysis. The other thing is that, again, the different sequence from the both species CB and CHB come together in a single clade. But it seems like there are two clades here. And these clades seem to be related with the geography. So this is a clade that contains primarily Conchita and Tamal from the north, and the second clade contains Bonaparte and Giliantia from the south, this year. So good, we have a pattern, but there are still a mess, a single clade. So we try to solve that using ultra-conserved elements. And this is what we got. We got a first clade, or a clade, where CH is a single seminoflated clade, and it seems to be nested inside CB. But what happened with the geographical pattern? We lose it. So, well, what we did, or what I am doing now, is use complete genome resequencing, whole genome resequencing, and from the first data we got from this complete genome resequencing, what we did was to assemble the complete mitochondrial genome. And this is the trim that we got. Nothing. All the white dots are polytomids. They are not well supported. And it seems like all of them are mixed. So, okay, the mitochondrial genome is a single thing here. There is not a geographical pattern, and all the subspecies seems to be one single thing. But what happened when we look at the SNPs from the nuclear genome? This is what we got, the result, which is pretty good. So here, we recovered the pattern that we saw previously with the UCEs. The CH are nested inside CD, and it seems like all of them are differentiated. Are you tired of the trees? So we can change now to Tarai to understand the mechanisms behind that. What we did was to use the UC data to test for the divergence with gene flow model of speciation. And this is what we got. This is the estimator parameter of migration through time. So this is the present, this is the past. This is the estimated time for the most recent common ancestor of both species. And what you see here is that most of the migration happened close to the time of divergence. And you don't have migration here in the present. So it's not hybrid. It's not hybridization in the present, but it's divergence with gene flow. But this could happen only if there is enough selection to counteract the homogenizing effect of migration. So when we do a PCA analysis of all the SNPs that we found, almost 2 million of the SNPs from the whole genome resequencing, we can separate very well the groups. And the first principal component seems to be related with the allopatry of this subspecies Conchita in comparison with the others. And this could be related also with, or we think that this could be related with ecological differences. The second principal component shows a separation of the subspecies mainly by coloration. So in the bottom we have the lighter species, subspecies, and at the top we have the darker one. Well, this is pretty good, but we need to test for that. So one thing that we did was to do a niche climatic niche overlapping analysis. This is for CB and CH. And what you see here is they are occupying the same climatic niche. So they are not different in the climatic conditions that they are inhabiting. But it seems like both the species are occupying different climatic conditions. So the green one has this space, and this one, this is CD. And CH has this one and also this one. But this could happen because of the subspecies. So we test for that, and this is what we got. Conchita and Bonaparte are effectively using different climatic conditions, while Tamai and Giliantia are using pretty much the same. So, well, this is what we got to this point. So what is in summary? In summary, you two predicted very well the evolutionary history between these two, where they are one in the mitochondrial genome, but they are not the same in the nuclear genome. And about the mechanisms behind that, we have divergence with gene flow, which is suggesting a lot of selection, that considering that we didn't found differences in the climatic niche, this could be related primarily with sexual selection, so we think that the differentiation in coloration is related with that. So that is pretty much that we have. But also we have the divergence between these two subspecies, and this could be related primarily with natural selections, considering the differences that we found in the climatic niche. So that being said, thank you very much. And I hope you have a lot of questions. I can continue.
Have you taken a look to your outlier SNPs for outlier FSTs?
No yet. The genomic data, actually I just present half of the genomic data that I am having, or that we are getting, because they came out just a couple of weeks before. So now what I want to do is to search for those peaks of divergence between these species. Are, if we are lucky, we're going to track difference in the coloration of how many species, structural and non-related pigmentation. That would be great.
So, when you found a broad overlap in the climatic niche space between the two colors, I imagine, was that mostly along the Cordillera Orienta? Because you have the distribution pretty distinct.
Yeah.
And I'm wondering, is there sort of like a thin band of high elevation peaks in there that they can't really get over?
Okay. Yeah, so we know for sure that they are in a parapodical zone here. And what happened, or what we see, is that they inhabit one slope and the other slope of the ranch, the mountain range there. So what we test actually was the Glover's rule about humidity and dry zones, because we know that this slope seems to be more humid than the other one, but we didn't found that differences. But yeah. Pretty much what is happening is that because they are in the same altitude zone, it's probably that they inhabit the same climate.